office. I'd like to welcome you to this morning's forum, a blueprint on meaningful criminal justice reform. I'm pleased to have my chief counsel, former chief counsel of the crime subcommittee, Bobby Vassar, here to moderate today's panel. I'd like to thank all of the distinguished guests who are really experts in this field for being with us this morning. And I think everybody who came here was probably aware, and if they've read or at least aware of Michelle Alexander's book, The New Jim Crow, Mass Incarceration in the Age of Colorblindness. Expert that kind of connects the dots and showing how too many people are incarcerated disproportionately for disproportionately African American. Shows that collateral consequences of incarceration and how this is the last vestige, last opportunity to really discriminate against people. When you have somebody coming up, you can't get a job because you're a woman, you can't get a job because you're black, you know, you can't do that anymore. But you can say, you can't get a job because you have a felony conviction. You can't vote because you have a felony conviction. You can't live here because you have a felony conviction. So long after the incarceration, people suffer those consequences, like it was the Jim Crow era. Like the experts here, she talks about the racial disparities, talks about the fact that many of the crimes for which people round it up are routinely committed in some communities without punishment, without policing, whereas in communities of college communities of low income, they're routinely rounded up and arrested and incarcerated. It's 22 years this month, September 13, 1994. President Clinton signed the 1994 Omnibus Crime Bill, which paid states to punish more severely and act things like abolishing parole and other things that kind of exacerbated the war on drugs that began by Richard Nixon in the 1980s. Excuse me, in the 1970s and was continued in the 1980s. They eliminated parole for federal prisoners in 1986. Established mandatory minimum sentences for drug offenses. Something productive, that you're actually adding to crime when you get over 500, 400,000, we're at 700, 40% above the counterproductive range. And if you just wonder what you could do with that kind of money in terms of early childhood education, after school programs, jobs programs, and other things that will actually do something to reduce crime, if you spent that kind of money on those initiatives rather than wasted on counterproductive incarceration. The war on drugs has made the problem worse. You've got 2,000 federal prisoners serving life without parole for nonviolent drug crimes, many nonviolent drug offenses generally. Racial disparities are obviously staggering, disproportionately people of color. On a positive side, it looks like states have caught on and are not following the madness today. 27 states have reformed their correction systems. 32 states have actually reduced crime and saved money by reducing incarceration over the past 5 years. Texas is one of the best examples. Texas legislature was told that they had to spend $2 billion in incarceration, $2 billion in the new prison building to keep up with the trend they were going in. Somebody said, well, if you spend $200 million intelligently, prevention, early intervention, rehabilitation, you might not have to spend all $2 billion in prisons. So they tried it, and look what happened. They didn't have to build any new prisons, and in fact, they were able to close some of the prisons they had. And so that's what kind of formed a coalition, because a lot of states looked up and said, well, if we can save that kind of money, maybe this tough on crime thing isn't such a good idea, particularly when we know not only doesn't work, we're wasting a lot of money on it. And so a lot of states have reformed their sentencing laws and made different investments and done criminal justice reform the right way and reduced crime and saved money. That was pretty much the genesis of the Safe Justice Act, authored by Jim Sensenbrenner and myself, to try to do criminal justice reform on the federal level. It is a comprehensive approach, starting with prevention and early intervention, with investments in communities to reduce crime and save money. Modeled after the Youth Promise Act, which puts money in comprehensive, evidence-based approach to get young people on the right track and keep them on the right track. Then it has police training. After the debate of what's going on with the police is over, the answer is going to be better training, properly body cameras. If you don't have money for training, you're not going to be able to make any improvements in terms of teaching them how to de-escalate, how to stop profiling, how to put implicit bias is, and those kinds of problems. That's an expensive process, and we have money in there for police training. We divert people pre-trial so people aren't losing their jobs, even if they're found not guilty. If you don't have money for bail, have to stay in jail for 30 days. How many people will have a job when that's over? How many people will even have their apartment when that's over? You lose 30 days worth of income, can't pay next month's rent, you've lost your job, lost your apartment, and are down the spiral, even if you're found not guilty. So we prefer a diversion pre-trial. When you get to trial, have problem-solving courts like drug courts to deal with the underlying problem, so that you don't have somebody coming in with a drug problem, get punished, come out, they got the same problem they went in with, just wait a few days, and they're going to be right back in. Just deal with the problem with the drug courts. The real money saver of the bill is a virtual elimination of mandatory minimums for drug cases. Mandatory minimums, these shocking sentences that people get 20, 30 years of nonviolent low-level offenses, have been a major factor in growing the prison population. If you look at the president's commutation plan, he announced that anyone who is a low-level, nonviolent first offender who has already served 10 years on a drug charge will be eligible for consideration for commutation of the sentence. Well, that's a great plan. It certainly sounds reasonable. But the first thing that ought to occur to you is, what in the world is a low-level, nonviolent first offender doing and getting so much time that after 10 years, they still need help? That's because of the mandatory minimums. We get rid of most of them, almost all of the mandatory minimums. And then we, in prison, everybody gets rehabilitation, not just a select few. Everybody gets rehabilitation, and when you get out, a second chance programs to support people. A comprehensive start to finish prevention, early intervention, rehabilitation approach to crime. Because it will save so much money, it's not been technically scored by CBO, but the mandatory minimum part of it generates the savings, and the savings can be reallocated to everything else in the program that costs money. There was a watered-down version of what we have that was reported in out of the Senate committee a couple of years ago. It was scored at about $4.7 billion over 10 years. A watered-down version. And frankly, I think our version would have at least twice as much savings to be generated, but we can just start it, and we know it's going to be at least $4 billion. We were doing fine. We've got broad bipartisan support, and Chairman Grassley, chair of the Judiciary Committee of the Senate, was quoted in the paper, quoted in a news article saying that he opposes the reduction in mandatory minimums, and the Safe Justice Act looked like it was going to pass, so he had to do something. So he offered an alternative. It has no elimination, no mandatory minimums eliminated, a lot of mandatory minimums, a few reduced, a few expanded, some new mandatory minimums. So when the dust settles, it's really hard to see how you have any fewer people coming out of jail than you got in the day. He offered it as an alternative. Chairman Goodland offered a virtual Xerox copy in the House. And when you look up, it became bipartisan. So now you have competing bills. I will tell you that the new mandatory minimums in the bill have virtually no impact on the criminal justice system. They apply to so few people that you can almost ignore them. But there is one major purpose for having new mandatory minimums in the bill, and that is so when people support it, they're supporting legislation with new mandatory minimums. It makes it impossible for us to cite studies that show that mandatory minimums are inherently reprehensible, bad policy, that they've been studied, they waste the taxpayers' money, they don't reduce crime, they discriminate against minorities, and frequently require judges to impose sentences that simply violate common sense. You can't make that case if a bill you just finished supporting has new mandatory minimums in it. That's the purpose of those, and they've got them in there and to show the effect. While the bill was pending, since the time it's been pending, in May of this year, the House passed three new mandatory minimums in May alone. Minor things, but we couldn't make the case that they're inherently reprehensible because a lot of people are supporting on a bipartisan basis a bill with new mandatory minimums in it. These savings, there's one good provision in all of these bills, and that's the retroactive application of the Fair Sentencing Act, which would reduce the notorious 100-to-1 crack powder cocaine disparity to 18-to-1. We're still trying to get to 1-to-1, but it's a significant improvement. That is made retroactive, so people who've been sentenced on those draconian mandatory minimums can get re-sentenced under the new law. The president is taking care of a lot of that. The bill passed about 7 years ago, 6 or 7 years ago. So if you got a 5-year mandatory minimum, you're already done. If you got a 10-year mandatory minimum, if it's passed 6 years ago, 60% are already out. By the time you get the regulation, 70% would be out. And the half the rest, the president's taking care of. So the savings in that would be a lot less than they have been portrayed because the calculation was made several months ago. But the total savings in that bill is calculated at about $700 billion. Half the crack powder cocaine disparity, a third subsequently negotiated out. One of the provisions that saved money was negotiated away. So you're down to about $200 million over 10 years. To give you an idea of what that means, 1,000 people at $30,000 each is $30 million a year, 10 years, $300 million. You're talking about 1,000, 2,000, certainly single-digit 1,000 people. Most maximum savings in that bill over 10 years. single-digit thousands. When you put in your press release that 2.2 million people in jail, you get to 2.1, that's 100,000. So the bill, unfortunately, has bipartisan support. We're not sure exactly what's going to happen. There's so many bad provisions that they're getting hit from both sides. Some don't want to do anything. Some want to do something significant. And whether they have enough in the middle to pass the bill, I don't know. But if it's defeated, we'll have the Safe Justice Act back on the table. There's one significant thing about as you consider all of the bills. There are a number of different issues that you ought to look at. One is, what does it do for mass incarceration? Are you really going to make a significant difference? Two, what are you doing for mandatory minimums? That's the primary driver of mass incarceration. What are you doing from dealing with drugs? Are you dealing with the war on drugs by adding penalties or by treating it as a public health situation? Let's treat it as a public health situation. We know that it works. The war on drugs didn't work. Is there a racial disparities? What are you doing about racial disparities? And finally, are you using evidence and research or just slogans and sound bites to develop your bill? One thing that Jim Sensenbrenner and I agreed on to begin with is there'd be nothing that would go on the bill that wasn't supported by evidence and research. Once you agree to that, the debate's pretty much over, because there's so much stuff that is supported by evidence and research that everybody can agree on, that you got too much stuff to put into one bill. If you have not agreed to that, then you're arguing, well, I think this makes sense. Another person has said, yeah, but my alternative holds at 70%. So although it doesn't make any sense, let's get it in the bill. And so you construct a bill that doesn't make much sense. But that agreement took place, and that was one of the reasons I think we got broad bipartisan support. Support on the right, primarily because of the massive cost savings. It will be in the billions of dollars easily. We'll reduce crime and save money. On the left, because it's got our criminal justice policy, and everybody working together, from the Koch brothers to Newt Gingrich to Grover Norquist, to all of the civil rights organizations, coming together on one bill was certainly an interesting coalition. Let me just mention one other thing that we just did this week, and that's the Juvenile Justice Delinquency Prevention Bill. Again, looking at prevention and early intervention as a way to deal with crime. We reported the bill. When we reauthorize some of these bills, like juvenile justice, that has protections for juveniles in the bill, we're always worried about whether or not they'll take a step backwards. Juvenile Justice Emergency Prevention Act of 1974 hadn't been reauthorized for at least 15 or 20 years, because when you get to reauthorizing it, they want to take a step backwards, and people say, we'll just leave well enough alone and don't do anything. We passed the bill that had forward steps in terms of the protections, and also had significant funding for prevention and early intervention initiatives. So that's pretty much where we are. I'm going to call Bobby Vassar, who is, as I said, former lead counsel on the Democratic side for the Crime Subcommittee on the Judiciary Committee. Prior to that, he was Secretary of Health and Human Services for the Commonwealth of Virginia. He was legislative director for me. Then he went to, he was Secretary of Health and Human Services from 1993 to 1994. He was Secretary of, that's what his resume says. For those who know the resume, the Secretary of Health and Human Services resigned in December of 1993. The administration went out in January of 1994. Bobby was Deputy Secretary, and so for about 3 weeks, he was Secretary of Health and Human Services. And he calls that 1993 to 1994. Yes. Anyway, before that, he was Deputy Director of social services in the Commonwealth of Virginia, and for criminal justice purposes, we were proud to have him serve as chairman of the Virginia Parole Board 4 years under Governor Rob. Before that, he was director of the legal aid program in Newport News, clearly qualified to speak on the social service implications and research implications of criminal justice reform. So please welcome Bobby Bassett.
Thank you, Congressman, and good morning. I just note that Congressman Scott fell for that 93 scam because he hired me. I'm pleased to join my former boss and this panel of distinguished experts to discuss the urgent need of criminal justice reform. When I retired 3 years ago as chief counsel for crime, I thought I'd left sufficient instructions so that by now criminal justice fund would be reform would be done, but I see that either my instructions were not sufficiently clear or not sufficiently followed for that, so I came back to give a little more guidance on what we need to do. And as part of looking at the foundation for how we got to the wasteful and costly state of affairs in criminal justice that Congressman Scott describes, I was asked to discuss my observations as an eyewitness to the process of that resulted in passage of the Violent Crime Control and Law Enforcement Act of 1994, or 94 Crime Bill in short, because it is one of the worst things that has happened for criminal justice in recent times. I can say it was not a pretty sight. For decades, the Republicans had monopolized and politically benefited from tough-on-crime slogans, and the Democrats, led by then-President Bill Clinton, were determined to take that posture away from them. Crime bill was chosen as the vehicle for making the Democrats the tough-on-crime party, and it definitely lived up to that. The bill led by then-Senator Joe Biden in the Senate and Judiciary Committee Chairman Jack Brooks in the House was jam-packed with all the protested political sound bites of the day. It included 60 new death penalties, including a non-homicide death penalty for drug kingpins that attempted or had others to attempt to murder a law enforcement officer or witness. Mandatory life without parole and other mandatory minimums. Three strikes, you're out. Truth in sentencing grants and haste states to abolish parole, which the federal government had already done, as the Congressman indicated. Do the adult time provision that authorized crying a child as young as 13 and sentencing the child as an adult. Sex offender registration, this one to be with law enforcement authorities. Enhanced sentencing for crimes by gang members and immigration recidivism provisions. Increased penalties for just about every other crime on the federal books. It also included billions of dollars for police, prosecutors, courts, and prisons to round up and imprison more people for longer periods. It included elimination of Pell Grants for prisoners, despite the clear evidence that they substantially reduced crime. Bobby Scott, a second-year member of Congress, led the fierce opposition to the crime bill by CBC members in the House. They met almost daily to develop and implement the opposition strategy that was so effective that it hung the bill up in the House several times. There were about 20 votes necessary to finally get the bill passed. One of the great successes of the CBC opposition was to get the Racial Justice Act put in the bill in the House, which allowed those facing a death sentence with all these new death penalties to use race statistics as part of the evidence when seeking to establish racial discrimination in the application of the death penalty in a particular case. However, in the conference process, the Senate just refused to agree to it, and it did not get into the final bill. Final analysis, the administration and Democratic leadership wooed and pressured all the Democrat members of Congress, including the CPC members, and a number of them ended up supporting the bill because of the Christmas tree-like political goodies in the bill. To be sure, the bill did authorize billions of dollars for prevention and family support program. This was a part of the so-called balance approach between law enforcement and prevention that's so beguiling. And it worked. It not only got the support of Democrats, enough Democrats in the Congress, and a number of Republicans, but also many juvenile, family, and community support organizations and individuals who endorsed the bill or agreed not to oppose it in exchange for the goodies that were put in that they thought would benefit their constituents. However, they learned that there's a very real distinction between authorized and appropriated. When Republicans won a majority in Congress that very year, they came in and transferred all of the goodies in the bill for prevention and other programs into more support for law enforcement. So the problem with this so-called balance approach is not only this authorized versus appropriation problem, but it presumes that to get anything sensible than a crime bill, you have to balance it with Neanderthal-like draconian punishment and counterproductive law enforcement increases. Unfortunately, as the congressman described, we're seeing that same process playing out now in bills in Congress. The balance approach still seems to hold great sway. And as long as we allow this simplistic and defective notion to operate, we'll remain in the limbo of being asked to take a step backward in order to take a step forward in criminal justice. Bills such as the Safe Justice Act and the Youth Promise Act, as the Congressman mentioned, don't include this balanced approach scheme. Now, after 22 years of crime bill and other provisions, most Democrats who supported the bill, including the Clintons and Biden, are now conceding error, or loading up our prisons, devastating minority and poor communities, and costing taxpayers hundreds of billions of dollars for counterproductive law enforcement and incarceration. Proof of just how unproductive all that incarceration is can be seen in the scant recidivism that's been shown among the tens of thousands of people who have since been released through legislation such as the Fair Sentencing Act, another Bonnie Scott-led effort in the House, federal and state pardons and sentence commutations, sentencing commission guideline reductions, and all the other state sentencing reforms across the country that the congressman referred to. As bad as the 94 crime bill was, the general criminal justice setting got even worse following it. In 1995, a U.S. Sentencing Commission study report that was directed under the crime bill established that crack and powder cocaine were the same drug from a scientific and pharmacological perspective, and that the crack form of the drug was no more a contributor to violence than the powder form. They found that just as with the violence associated with powder cocaine wars in Miami in the 80s, the violence surrounding crack was associated violence as well, and not due to any pharmacological difference in crack compared to powder. Nor were so-called crack babies born to crack-addicted mothers found to be incurable zombies born to a life of permanent brain and developmental damage, as had been suggested. As a result of the crack powder study, the Sentencing Commission adopted a guideline amendment eliminating the 101 sentencing disparity between crack and powder to have them sentenced the same. Yet, despite this study and despite the Million Man March, where removal of the crack powder disparity was adopted as the number one priority for the marchers, for the Congress, the very next day after the march, the Congress voted to overturn the Sentencing Commission amendment. The first time the Congress had overturned an amendment in the Sentencing Commission history. To further add insult to the injury of over-incarceration, in 1996, Congress enacted the Anti-Terrorism and Effective Death Penalty Act and the Prison Litigation Reform Act. Prosecutors and Congress felt that too many inmates were getting their defective death penalty sentences overturned through appeals, so they so severely limited their access to appeals that they would be executed before they could get DNA analysis or other remedies to show they were indisputably innocent. That was happening more and more at the time. Under the Effective Death Penalty Act, if you could only show on appeal that you were probably innocent, that was no longer enough. Now, under that act, you have to show by clear and convincing evidence that you're innocent, such as indisputable DNA. Otherwise, you just have to be executed, regardless of your innocence. Thank God for DNA and other science that has debunked all the junk science of bloodhounds and fire analysis and other forensics that put innocent people in jail that now they're able to show was no reliable basis. Prison Litigation Reform Act was deemed necessary because too many prisoners were able to prove their conditions of confinement were so grossly depraved and brutal as to be unconstitutional. So the Congress limited the ability of inmates to get access to courts to bring such cases, and they were very effective because they dried up for the most part. For example, under Prison Litigation Reform Act, unless you can show physical injury, even from a rape, and that you've exhausted the grueling state process, you can't even ask for a hearing in the federal courts. Other provisions included the Personal Responsibility and Work Opportunity Reconciliation Bill, the bill to end welfare as we know it, which included a provision that banned for life people with felony drug convictions for ever receiving food stamps. In 1997, the Congress adopted the Adoption and Safe Families Act that made it easier for prisoners to be taken from them, any absent parents, such as prisoners, were adversely affected. And in 1998, the Higher Education Act denied student loans to people with a drug history or drug conviction while a student. Some of these restrictions have since been lessened by federal or changes in state options, but far too many obstacles remain, as the Congressman noted, including voting and other civic restrictions, restrictions on work, travel, and other activities that prevent people from being fully successful in fulfilling and contributing lives after prison. Prisoners still can't get who cut hair in prison, for example. In some states, can't even get a license to do so after they leave because of their record. So all of us are adversely affected by all the counterproductive incarceration that occurred and continues to occur in this country, given the human and financial costs it imposes on us, our relatives, our friends, our neighbors, and fellow citizens. So we have every reason to get on with adopting effective strategies for reversing the incarceration binge that has occurred and hamper counterproductive activities. We have ways to do that, such as the Safe Justice Act and the Youth Promise Act, and we have a panel of experts this morning that will give you more details on just how that can be done. I've given a little something of the historical context, and so I want to introduce our panel of experts who can help us shape a blueprint for meaningful criminal justice reform. Each panel will be provided up to 10 minutes to make a statement, and we're going to start out with Vinnie Giraldi, who is a senior research fellow directing the program in criminal justice policy and management at Harvard Kennedy School and directs the project for Justice in a New Century, a policy reform and research effort provisionally supported by the Lauren John Arnold Foundation. He has a long and distinguished career in public life as the founder of the Justice Policy Institute, director of the Juvenile Corrections in Washington, D.C., and then as commissioner of the New York City Department of Probation. Mr. Spiroldi also served as senior advisor to the New York City Mayor's Office of Criminal Justice. While he was in D.C., he worked tirelessly with us on our efforts to address problems with our criminal justice system, particularly the juvenile system, which you'll give us some detail on. And I'll introduce each of our other panelists just before they speak. So at this time, I'd like you to have been involved. Yes, we have with us the mayor of Newport News. Mayor McKinley Price, would you please stand for our audience? Thank you, Mayor. And also, with him is his lovely wife, Valerie McKinley, and their daughter and Virginia delegate. Marcia Price. Sister, brother-in-law, and niece. Thank y'all for being here.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I put my little, so you know, I'm checking email, I'm just doing a little timer, so I... we're going to pop up my PowerPoint here. As Bobby mentioned, thank you for that introduction, Bobby. I ran the juvenile justice system here in Washington, D.C. from 2005 to 2010. It was one of the most sort of emotional experiences of my life doing that. When we took over, Mark and I both ran the system. Mark was the chief of staff and general counsel. Kids were being regularly beaten up by staff, placed into isolation cells for extensive periods of time, again, like trivial misbehavior. The kids told us that they used to take their shirts off and stuff them around the toilet so that rats and cockroaches didn't crawl up on them and bite them at night and show us the bites that they had. Staff were sexually assaulting the kids. They were sexually assaulting one another. Young female staff learned very quickly that if they didn't perform sexually for your supervisor, they might find themselves in compromising positions with the youth in the facility, and no aid would be forthcoming. Staff were selling drugs to the kids. We actually knew who was selling drugs to the kids. And drugs were so prevalent in the facility that some kids who tested negative, didn't have drugs in their system when they came in, tested positive after 30 days in the facility. And it was about as bloody a mess as you can imagine, as I think will surprise no one in this room. For the 5 years I ran that system, not one white kid was committed to our care. 5 years. Overwhelmingly African American, a handful of Latino kids. And I looked at the crime statistics, it's not because white kids weren't committing crimes. When you're a government appointee, you kind of check your First Amendment rights at the door, right? Everything has to be approved by some 23-year-old at City Hall before you can say that. I can say what I want to say. One of the first things I did was write this paper. It's going to be released on October 21st about the future of youth justice. And he's, what's that? Well, yeah, just I'm good. Thanks. And the essential question we're asking is, can we have a system in America that doesn't have large locked institutions like the one I described? Ours was called Oak Hill. It was a terrible, debilitating, awful place. I've been there. Consent decree for 20 years, and during that, a federal court order, a court order, not federal, and during that 20 years, during that 19 years, I was the 20th director of the department. So we were coming and going more than 1 year. Right? So can we actually have a system that that just doesn't have large lot prisons for kids. And we think in this paper that the overwhelming majority of the preponderance of evidence is that we can, that we can change the system so that there are no longer these large lot institutions like Oak Hill. And by the way, that wasn't an outlier. That is far more the experience of young people in these institutions than otherwise. So this is just an outline of my presentation. I'm just going to zip past it because you'll see it when it comes, right? And then I only got 10 minutes. So we looked into the history. And by the way, at the end, my email address is going to be up there. You might want to copy it down because we're going to release this on October 21st to the Justice Department. And it's going to be simulcast, so you can watch it wherever you want. And if you email me, I will send you the information as to how you can watch this panel, which will include a prosecutor, a defense attorney, a juvenile correctional administrator, a kid, a family member, advocate at the Justice Department. So we'll discuss this at length. So we started these reformatories in essence to kind of scoop the children of immigrants who were running the streets in our cities, right? It was industrialization, it was an enormous amount of immigration. Irish kids and Eastern European kids were running the streets while their parents worked endless hours in sweatshops and factories, and they were getting in trouble forming gangs. So this communist left-right combination got together and said, we should think of some other way to help these kids out, but also to get them the heck out of our cities. And that was the reformatory. And it was an alternative, a main supposedly alternative to the poorhouses, and was instantly, showed signs of problems, of deep, deep problems, the problems that we live with to this day. In the 1900s, they invented the juvenile court, a separate court for juveniles in Chicago, and that actually gave more life to the reformatories. There was blistering criticism of them, but the progressives believed that we could fix these institutions. They were big believers that we could fix elements of government, so they thought we could fix these juvenile facilities and turn them around. So they actually thrived under the progressives. In the 60s, the Supreme Court started to more and more offer their opinions about, their opinions are binding, about how the juvenile system really wasn't delivering on its promise of rehabilitation, but it also wasn't providing protections to the kids. So the kids had what the Supreme Court called the worst of both worlds. They didn't have the same same legal protections that adults had. For example, they didn't have the right to confront witnesses. They didn't have the right to prove beyond a reasonable doubt. But they also weren't getting the kinds of rehabilitations that the system promised. So that was the 60s. Then in the 80s and 90s, we had the super predator era. I think both Representative Scott and Bobby mentioned that era. And there was a racialized attack demonizing young people that resulted in a huge increase in the number of young people incarcerated, and actually for a part of that time period, all of the increase in juvenile incarceration were kids of color. White kids actually slightly declined. And I'm not talking rates, I'm talking actual numbers. And the numbers peaked at 109,000 in 1999. So this engendered its own backlash. And that backlash came in the form of advocates who fought against this increasing incarceration. It came in the form of elected officials like Representative Scott, but it also came in the form of research funded by the MacArthur Foundation and the Justice Department. Because what was essentially being attacked was the notion that that kids deserved a different court, that they were different enough from adults to deserve a different court. And that's why the rallying cry of those attacking this was, you do the adult crime, you do the adult time. So that was, in essence, saying, there's really no difference between kids and adults. Why do they get this special court that treats them better? And the research answered that question and found several research-backed developmental psychology and neurobiology findings that showed that kids were more volatile in emotionally charged settings, they were more prone to peer influence, they were greater risk takers, and they were greater risk takers and less future oriented. You know, and as the kids would say, duh, right? If anybody's got a teenager, they're not future oriented, right? They're not thinking until after this afternoon. And that extended, I still got a 22-year-old who's not really thinking until afternoon. And that period in which young people were developmentally different than adults was extended if they had suffered brain trauma, which about half the kids in the juvenile system had. So those are serious, serious findings. And what they called for is what I have up on the screen. It means that, okay, what do kids need in modeling pro-social behavior, in the opportunity to make decisions and try those decisions out? All the stuff we do as adolescents, right? You go out there, you make decisions, you practice your critical thinking, you have positive youth-adult interactions. It's the stuff you all want for your kids, right? You put them on a football team so they have a good coach. You send them to church so they get, mentored by the minister. And but what do we do in institutions? We strip all of that from kids. Like, none of that stuff happens. You don't get to make your own decisions. You wake up when somebody tells you. You go to bed when somebody tells you. You eat what they tell you to eat. You do none of the decision making, right? And so the research increasingly shows that hinders your chance at the kinds of things that help you matriculate out of juvenile delinquency. It's not just that your brain matures. It's that you get married, you get a job, you stop hanging out with the boys, and you behave better, gentlemen, right? I mean, that's what happened to all of us, right? So the point of the article is that this is not idiosyncratic. Too many of us experience these atrocities in institutions as if they're idiosyncratic. We hear of these horrible things happening in our state's facilities and say, what is wrong with the superintendent of that facility? Those staff need to be punished. What's the governor's problem? Why isn't he fixing this? So we individualize it. And certainly, if people are doing horrible things to kids in institutions, they need to be held accountable. But it's the very nature of these systems that we are pointing out in the paper, of these large institutions, that inevitably integrate into this kind of abuse of kids. So this is just a quote from the Justice Department. Analysis they did of a facility in New York State. Anything from sneaking an extra cookie to initiating a fistfight can result in a full chrome restraint with handcuffs. This one-size-fits-all approach has, not surprisingly, led to an alarming number of serious injuries to youth, including concussions, broken or knocked-out teeth, and spiral fractures. If you go on the Justice Department's website, you see finding after finding after finding of institutions around the country that look like this. Again, it's not idiosyncratic, it's endemic. This is a map of all the state systems that have found atrocities like this in their departments between 1970 and 2015. The only ones that have are the three ones with no color, the three white ones. So all the states almost have had this atrocity. 1 in 8 young people in institutions reports being sexually assaulted. Okay, I'm throwing a lot of numbers on here. 1 in 8 kids in the care and protection of state systems reports being sexually assaulted during their incarceration. The Associated Press did an analysis. They did Freedom of Information Acts to the juvenile correctional institutions around the country and found 13,000 allegations of abuse in facilities holding 46,000 youth. And anybody who knows these young people knows they tend not to report these assaults. This is an undercount. Nobody wants to snitch. First of all, they don't want to snitch, period. Second of all, they don't want to snitch. Because typically nothing happens when they tell anybody except the guard beats them up again. So why don't we just fix these places? Why close them all down? That seems pretty extreme. Why not fix them? Well, Jerome Miller was a great leader in this field and a mentor of mine. He passed away last year. And he actually closed all the correctional facilities down in Massachusetts when he was head of the juvenile program. He moved all the kids into a network of community programs, the kind of community programs envisioned under Representative Scott's Youth Promise Incentive Grant, right? So, and here's what Jerry said. First, he didn't start thinking I'm gonna close them all down. He started thinking I'm gonna fix them, right? And so he came in and said, look, reformers come and reformers go. State institutions carry on. Nothing in their history suggests that they can sustain reform, no matter what money, what staff, and programs are pumped into them. The The same crises that have plagued them for 150 years intrude today. Though the cast may change, the players go on producing failure. There is no question the staff in DC thought that. There is no question. I was the 20th director, and they were looking for the 21st. Because we opened it in the first 5 minutes, we opened it with speeches. Right? They're the ones left there with the kids. Mark's going to talk about the costs and benefits, so I'm going to zip past that. As Congressman Scott talked about earlier, we lead the world in this. This is new data. This is actually, we calculated this data for this. So we have an incarceration rate for juveniles at 6 times the Russian Federation. Should be ashamed to say. Hayward Burns Institute does the best work in the country on looking at racial disparities in the juvenile justice system. This shows disparities statewide. So if you go on the Hayward Burns Institute's website, you can actually click on this and see what the disparities are in your state. The redder they are, the more disparities they are. So African Americans are locked up at 4.7 times the rate of white kids. Native Americans at 3.3 times. Latinos at 1.7 times. And Asians 30% more frequently. Some states are off the hook. New Hampshire, African Americans are locked up at 37 times the rate of African American kids. This is all juveniles. New Jersey, 25 times. Wisconsin, 16 times. And unlike the adult system, where the disparities are slightly declining, although still outrageous, the juvenile system disparities are growing, they're actually increasing. A couple of research, bits of research on racial bias show that when you factor out prior record and current offense, there's still bias in the system. But some people say, well, they commit more crimes, that's why they get locked up more. That's all. And that there's great evidence on research of probation reports that bias creeps its way into these probation reports, and staff recommend kids time to wrap up for being locked up at greater rates, again, even when, if they're African American or Latino, even when you control for prior record and current offense. Our four recommendations are to reduce incarceration, reform the kinds of community programs that we provide for kids reallocation of money to fund community programs. Many good evidence-based programs are out there now that really do show great promise, and that's the kind of thing that youth promise incentive grants would help fund. Replace and close these large locked facilities with smaller, decent, more humane places close to where people come from, and then reinvest that money back into programs. The state of Virginia, a couple of Virginia guys here, Virginia folks in the audience, has reduced its incarceration rate for juveniles by 40% over the last 2 years, just 2 years, under Governor McAuliffe and the terrific department head Andy Block. And the governor has come out for the closure of the remaining two institutions in Virginia, Beaumont, I think the other one, Del Air.
Bonaire,
sorry. And they're on their way to closing the first one down. And importantly, they're going to capture the savings. This is very difficult from government, so don't trivialize this. They're going to capture those savings, pump them into the community, so that the young people don't just get released, but they get released with help, so that their families have the kinds of help that they're going to need to help turn these young people's lives around, which is what any one of us would want from any of our kids. So I'm going to stop there. And
next, I want to call on Benny's partner in crime, as you see, Mark Schindler, who's executive director of the Justice Policy Institute that Benny used to direct. This is a national nonprofit organization that researches, analyzes, and identifies effective criminal justice programs and policies. And I know that's correct because he's my partner in crime, too. I'm on his board. A dedicated justice system reformer, Mark has partnered with nonprofit philanthropic investment organizations and served in a variety of leadership roles at DC's Juvenile Justice Agency, again partnering with Benny, including chief of staff and interim director. Mark also served as staff attorney with the Youth Law Center, advocating for the rights of young people in the juvenile justice and child welfare systems. is also a former Baltimore City public defender, is a recognized expert in the field, providing commentary on CNN and NPR, and is also the author of numerous articles and book chapters. He will also tell us more about issues and solutions for our juvenile justice system. Please welcome Mark Chin.
So before I jump into this, as Vinny said, I'm going to talk a little bit about the cost of what we're spending to lock up young people in the country. But I want to just quickly reflect for a moment. So I came to Washington 20 years ago as a young lawyer, or at least a younger lawyer at that time, working for the Youth Law Center. And I had the privilege at that time, that was as Representative Scott and Bobby Vassar talked about, a very challenging time in our country, and particularly here in Congress around juvenile justice. We had things like the Youth Predator Act that was introduced in 1996, Violent Youth Predator Act. But let me just pause for a moment. You know, in some ways, until our current presidential campaign, you can imagine use of legislation in Congress being introduced with the word predator that was regarding them. And so that's what we were up against. And I showed up here just having moved here from Baltimore, having been a public defender. And you know, the first people I met in many ways were Representative Scott and Bobby Vassar, Denise Fort, who's not here but who has returned to work for Mr. Scott. And these were the people who fought that battle every day to make sure that that bill didn't pass, and are still fighting those battles 20 years later. So I just want to thank both Representative Scott and Bobby Vassar. And personally, I hope that Mr. Scott maybe will be fighting those battles in the other chambers. Make history as the next senator of the great Commonwealth of Virginia. So I just wanted to share that. So just quickly, following up on Vinny's comments, you know, he just laid out, I think, incontrovertible facts about why youth prisons are a complete and utter failure in our country. I would put forth the only reason they're allowed to continue to sustain themselves, the only reason we have the types of policies we do in our juvenile justice system, that send kids to the adult system, is because they're filled with black and brown kids. Right? If they were filled with kids who look like my kids, we wouldn't even be having this conversation. So I think just without you know, question. So there's another element to this, which is if they're such utter and complete failures, well, God hopes we're not spending lots of money on that, right? But of course, we know that's not the case. So my organization, the Justice Policy Institute, we have our board members sitting here, we have our former executive director sitting here. We're proud to continue to put information out on these issues. And we took a look at the cost of these facilities, right? And what we're getting for our taxpayer dollars. This is your money, folks, that's paying for this.
Left and right.
Thank you. So we looked at the average cost of correctional facilities around the country by state. And we found that average, we are spending $150,000 a year to lock up a young person in one facility. Right? Think about what it costs to send a young person to your finest university in your state. And we're spending so much more, right? 33 states spend more than $100,000 a year for these young people, right? Annual costs range from $46,000 to, in New York, $352,000, right? And that was partly because New York was downsizing their facilities, so that was cost per kid because they had so few kids. Literally, they had facilities that were open and fully staffed with no kids in them, right? But generally, these are unbelievably expensive places to live. Jane and I ran the facility here in Washington. We can tell you that's the case. And what goes into these costs, right, are trying to do treatment, but a lot of unionized facilities, high salaries, privatized facilities, and in some cases, a little less so these days, overcrowded facilities, which are very expensive, right? So that's a huge amount of money, right? And we've known this for a while. And I think in recent years, both on the juvenile and on the adult side, that's come to the attention of state policymakers, particularly on the appropriations committees and in governor's offices, because they were not able to sustain the cost. I think that has helped us to try to drive down the populations, right? But that's just the direct cost. That's just what it costs to run the facility. We all pay a lot more in indirect costs. So some of you may be familiar with some economic studies that we've seen over the last decade or so, looking at indirect costs of the justice system and other things in our society, right? And so we pulled that information together, the best economic studies we could find and talk to people who knew about this stuff, and we found that there's other costs that we can quantify in terms of what locking up young people costs us in terms of our future and current dollars. So we know that there's victims and taxpayers, right, and we pay for that. The likelihood of a young person, once they go through one of these facilities, it's less likely that they'll earn future dollars, right? So we lose future earnings. If they're not in decent jobs, making it through school, we lose that tax revenue, right? They're more likely to end up on public benefits, right? So Medicare and Medicaid, right? And then we have medical expenses, as Vinny talked about. There's a lot of bad stuff that goes on in these facilities, including sexual assaults and other types of assaults. So we pay medical expenses and pain and suffering from that, right? So we totaled all that up, right? And what we found is that total between $8 and $20 billion a year we are paying as a country to lock kids up in our juvenile facility. So just, that's a big number. Try to wrap your arm around that. And think about that in terms of the outcomes we're getting, right, as Vinny described. So this is a monumental waste of public dollars, right? And we believe we can do so much better, and we know how to do better. Interestingly, this number could have been worse. So there's a lot of talk, good discussion going on in our country today about reducing the adult prison population. JPI and others are involved in that conversation. And there's talk about, can we cut 50? How many folks have heard that being talked about? Can we possibly cut the prison population by 50%? Well, as Vinny referenced, we've actually done that on the juvenile justice side over the past 10 years or so, right? So it went from a high of 109,000 to now less than 50,000 kids in juvenile facilities. So we've cut it by 50%. And thank goodness we did, because had we not had those reductions in juvenile incarceration, the cost that we would have been paying would have been that much higher. So the estimated cost, if we had not reduced by that amount, is between $14 and $40 billion a year that we would be spending on juvenile incarceration, direct and indirect. Again, enormous amount of money that I think we could think of a lot of different things we could do with those dollars had we had the opportunity, right? So this is very significant. But it does demonstrate as well that we can reduce incarceration and not have crime rates. We can do much better. reduction of, now it's about 53% in juvenile incarceration, also includes a significant number of kids who were charged and found guilty of violent offenses, right? So there's a lot of talk in our country about getting nonviolent offenders out of prison, which of course we should do, right? There's no question about that. But we also have to have the courage and the wisdom to talk about, there are folks who are in prison, in juvenile facilities, charged and convicted of violent crimes that we can manage well in the community. That's a time check. So I'm going to quickly go through some conclusions, right? This is going to be, I think, obvious to, as part of this discussion, right? We can't just needlessly confine young people. We have to understand what it costs and the alternatives that we have. We can spend this money in a much different way, further up in the system, in the types of programs that Congressman Scott is talking about, the Youth Promise Act. You know, I just think that what he's brought to the table and what he talked about at the beginning, that nothing in these bills should be in there that's not supported by evidence and research. That shouldn't be a radical proposition, should it? As opposed to soundbite policy, right? So Mr. Scott has been the leader now for, you know, decades in putting that forward. I think we're finally starting to see some of that in the legislation that's coming forward, right? A couple of other recommendations. It's actually hard to quantify, so we gotta do a lot of digging to get those numbers. We should be able to get that information very quickly. So you as taxpayers should be able to contact your representative, your governor's office, and say, how much are we spending per day to lock up a young person? How can we spend that differently? So we need to do some work in the research field to make sure we get to that. This is just a graphic to give you a sense, again, of what you're spending. And we view this, the direct cost, as the tip of the iceberg. Right? And then some recommendations, right? Again, let's spend the money up front, right? Community-based programs, which are much more cost-effective and much more effective, right? Let's identify the barriers in local and state government as to why we're continuing to rely on this outdated and dangerous approach. We can improve these systems and get better outcome measures, get better recidivism. When we downsized here in Washington, when we came in 2005, there was about 250 kids locked up in that horrible place, Oak Hill. We downsized, we built a small facility. As of this summer, there were 25 or 30 kids in secure confinement in D.C. compared to 250, and recidivism has gone down, right? So we can do this, we know how to do this, we need to push this as we move forward. There's my contact information. I'm not gonna ask Paul to share it with you. And then I'll just close quickly. The last thing I'll say is this was a good week in Washington for juvenile justice. Through Congressman Scott's leadership, the House passed unanimously out of the Ed and Workforce Committee legislation that's bipartisan. It's very similar to the legislation that already passed on a bipartisan basis in the Senate. So we have a tremendous opportunity, my hope, before this Congress closes down, that we can pass the Juvenile Justice Delinquency Prevention Act, which has been a very positive support for kids around the country for, you know, going back to the 70s. So through Congressman Scott's leadership, I think we have a chance at doing this. I'd encourage folks to weigh in, as I know you know how to do, and we can get this done and move forward with the types of reforms that we've been talking about. So I look forward to the discussion today, and just appreciate the opportunity to be here. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Next, I'd like to call on Professor Paul Butler of the Georgetown University Law School. We've heard about the juvenile system, and Professor Butler will tell us more about the adult system and some of the issues and problems there. Professor Butler researches and teaches in the area of criminal law, race relations law, and critical theory at the law school. His scholarship has been published in many leading scholarly journals, including the Yale Law Journal, the Harvard Law Journal, Law Review, the Stanford Law Review, and the UCLA Law Review. is the author of the widely reviewed Let's Get Free, A Hip-Hop Theory of Justice. His upcoming book, The Chokehold, Releasing Black Men, will be published in 2017. As a butler served as a federal prosecutor with the U.S. Department of Justice, where his specialty was public corruption. Please welcome Professor Butler.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen of the jury. My name is Paul Butler, and I represent the United States. That's how I used to start my opening statement. I was a prosecutor right here in the District of Columbia. I represented the government in criminal court, and I used that power to put black people in prison, and Latino people, and poor people. Like a lot of prosecutors, that was pretty much the only thing I did. During the time I did that work, I learned some things that changed the ways that I felt about my responsibilities as a American, an African American, as a lawyer, and as a person who wants to make a difference in this world. So Congressman Scott asked me to talk about what I learned about bias, about police bias, and about prosecutorial bias. Before Eric Holder was our visionary attorney general, he was the first black prosecutor, head prosecutor here in the District of Columbia. And when you went for your interview with him to be a prosecutor, he had this famous question. He'd ask every single applicant to that office, how are you going to feel about locking up so many black people? I just wondered what would be a great answer to that question. What if he said, oh, I would love it. That's why I'm going to do this. Eric Holder is a good man. I'm sure that was not the answer that he was looking for. But the question communicated that if you have a big problem with locking up black people, being a prosecutor is not good work for you. So how did we get to this state of affairs? If you walk about half a mile from here, you go to the criminal court in D.C. right now, you would think that white people don't commit crimes. White people, about 50% of the city, somewhere between 45-50% of the city, they are not present in the criminal court. Why is that? So a short version of my next few minutes is really just everything that Vinny and Mark said about children also applies to adults. The longer version. Where do these statistics come from? What does it mean that there are more African-American people in criminal justice under criminal justice supervision now than there were slaves in 1850? What does it mean that if you're a black man in your 1940s and you don't have a high school degree, you're more likely to be locked up than you are to have a job? How did we get there? So we can think about two different kinds of ways that people get admitted to prison, two big ways. One we've heard about, the war on drugs. What about bias there? It depends on what you mean by bias. So I'll walk over to, let's say take the Metro to the National Institute of Health. And they'll tell you that African Americans don't use drugs more than any other group. We're about 13% of the population, about 13% of people who use drugs. Most studies say people buy drugs. It's a segregated transaction, like most of our transactions. People report buying drugs from people of their own race. About 13% of the sellers, 13% of the buyers are African Americans. So leave NIH and take the red line over to the Department of Justice. Who's locked up for that crime? About 60% are black. 13% of people who do the crime, 60% of people who do their crime for drugs. So how should we think about that? It's clearly something racial is going on, right? Is bias the best way of thinking about that? I have a lot of top friends from my days as a prosecutor. They say, most of them, my top buddies are African American, and they say, of course, I selectively enforce the drug laws in African American neighborhoods. That's my community. That's community that I care about. So they think that they're doing the community a favor. Sometimes you hear another theory that black people commit crimes more in public. Privacy is a commodity. That's one of the things that we can't afford as much as white people. So transactions happen more outside, it's easier for police to make those arrests when they're happening in public. So what about those ideas? So first of all, this idea that law enforcement is good for the community. I don't want the dope boys in my car. So then I think, well, what's the best way to get rid of them? We know that we can't arrest and incarcerate our way out of that problem. There's something going on, fancy term that economists use called the replacement effect. But what that means is if the police lock up Xavier, the next day on that corner is Javier. They lock up Javier. Next day on that corner is Carlos. They lock up Carlos. Next day, Kwame is there. So that's one way that we get to this situation where one out of three young African-American men have a criminal case. Cities like Baltimore and New York, there have been Baltimore and D.C., there have been times when that number has been around 50%. About half of our young men are either locked up, awaiting trial, on probation, or parole. That's the war on drugs. Now, sometimes if you listen to the efforts about reform, the successful efforts have been with regard to the war on drugs. We made a lot of progress here, in part thanks to the visionary leadership of persons like Congressman Scott. That's not the main thing that's driving incarceration. The war on drugs is not the main thing that's driving incarceration. So in the federal system, which properly Congressman Scott has paid the most attention to because that's what, as a federal congressperson, that's what he's got the most power over. In the federal system, about half the people who are there are there for a drug-related crime. So it's a big deal in the federal system. Nationally, though, when you think about the 2.5 million people locked up, only 10% of those folks are in federal prison. About 90% are in state prison. So state prison is where the real problem is. And if we look at, well, what are people in state prison for? Only about 20% are there for drug crimes. That's still way too many. But it's 20%. 50% are there for violent crimes. Okay, so how about that? Why are 50% of people in prison for violent crimes, and what are the racial effects here? Can we think about bias? Well, once again, it's gonna depend on what you mean by bias. If you look at who commits the most serious violent crimes, let's think about homicide, let's think about armed robbery. The statistics about rape aren't as reliable, so let's focus on homicide and armed robbery. About 50% of the people who commit those crimes are black, almost exclusively black men. So what's going on there? About 7% leave African-American men, or about 7% of the population, or about 50% of people who commit certain kinds of violent crimes, somewhere between 45 and 50. So, does that make you think differently about the fact that so many people are in prison for violent crimes and that so many are black? Is it still possible to think about the difference that race makes with regard to that figure? So, we know that African American men don't commit crimes because we're African American and male. We know, for example, that what makes people at risk for committing a violent crime are really two main things. One, living in a high poverty neighborhood. Two, with easy access to guns. People who live in high poverty neighborhoods, 80% African American and Latino. And I don't have to tell you about how easy it is to get guns in those neighborhoods. But I told a kid in one of those neighborhoods, get me a gun and get me the Nutrient Pro by Michelle Alexander. If you can probably find the guns, that's how easy it is for kids to get guns, for adults to get guns. But again, when you add that to a high poverty neighborhood, that's a combustible mix. So again, what Vinny and Mark said about kids, same things applies to adults, including with violent crimes. We have to start thinking of it as a public health issue, treatment in addition to punishment. What Mark said about brain development, guess what? It does not stop at 17. I've got a 22, 23-year-old in my life, and trust me, that kid has a lot of brain development left to do. I know that from my own experience, but I also know it from science. The science tells us that our brains finally finish developing in about 25. So that same stuff that Mark was saying about not appreciating risk, not planning for the future, same thing applies to people who are most at risk for committing violent crime. Sentences for drug crimes way too long. Sentences for violent crimes also way too long. In terms of keeping our neighborhoods safe, keeping our families whole, we don't need to lock up folks for nearly the amount of time you lock them up for violent crime. You're safer walking on the streets in Paris and London, in Tokyo, and people go to prison way less than they go to prison here. So, you know, last thing, you can't do it in 30 seconds, but obviously everyone's concerned about violence by the police, police violence against, think of Eric Garner, think of Michael Brown. What do you do about that? So the remedy that people think about a lot is the Justice Department coming in, taking over the local police department. Two concerns, just I'll close with those two concerns. One is there are 18,000 police departments in the United States. The Justice Department has done about 200 investigations, more under President Obama than anybody else, but 200 versus 18,000, that's clearly not the only or best way to go. And the other thing is, we don't even have good long-term evidence of what happens when the department does take over those investigations. The department itself has never done a long-term empirical study to get results. When other people looked at results, guess what happens? About half the time, police violence goes down. About half the time, police violence actually goes up. In Prince George's County, the federal government took over that police department. Use of force by the police department actually went up. The police were nicer about it. That's one of the things that happens in those investigations. Procedural justice, that's the idea that the police should treat people better and then they feel better about the encounter. So citizens actually felt better in Prince George's County, but the use of violence actually went down. Again, what we see is that happens about half the time. So again, half the time violence going down means that fewer people are being beat up and killed by the police. That's a good thing. But we really need what the congressman was saying. We need more evidence. We need more data to think about ways to make our police serve and patrol all of our citizens more effectively. And finally, we need a change. I think reform is too mild a word for the problems with our system now. We need transformation. So President Obama has talked about transforming the way that police think about their work from a warrior mentality to a guardian mentality. So on the ground, practically what that might mean is paying police better so that we get better qualified people. We know that police officers with college degrees use force less than people who don't have college degrees. We know that women officers use force a lot less than male officers. So again, you want to think not just about reform because the problem is too vast. You want to think about transformation.
Thanks, Bob. Our next speaker is Peter Reddy, who is a senior research fellow at Charles Koch Institute. He's an attorney, a researcher, and a writer from Fort Worth, Texas, with a particular focus on state and federal corrections policy and on counterproductive regulation via overfederalization. He was the chief coordinator of the National Right on Crime campaign and has published editorials in several outlets, including USA Today, National Review, the National Law Journal, and the Houston Chronicle. He serves on the executive committee of the Criminal Law Practice Group of the Federalist Society and is an appointee to the U.S. Commission on Civil Rights, Texas, and advisory committee. Pete Grant is going to speak to us about some of the reflections he has. conservatives on the issue of criminal justice reform. So please welcome Chief.
Thank you very much, Bobby, and thank you so much, Representative Scott, for inviting me to participate tonight. This is really an extraordinary panel. Everybody up here is viewed as a major leader in this field, so it's a great honor to be a leader of that. And it's a great honor to address all of you. In the 10 minutes that I have, what I'm going to try and do is answer the question that I am most frequently asked by people who know I'm involved in criminal justice reform, and that is, why are conservatives suddenly so interested in this issue? You get together in your vast right-wing conspiracy rooms. What are you talking about that has gotten you guys interested in this topic? I think fundamentally it comes down to three things. Those three things are public safety, costs, and human dignity. And I'm going to go through them one at a time. The first is the public safety question. Representative Scott talked quite a bit about this. I don't want to repeat too many of his points, but I thought he was very articulate talking about how you get to a point with incarceration where you have diminishing returns. People often have this impression that, well, if you want to make the streets safer, you find the bad guy, you put him behind bars, you got rid of him, we're a little bit safer. This is true up to a point. Beyond a certain point, it actually becomes very counterproductive. You take a low-level, nonviolent offender and put him behind bars in a cell with somebody who is a very serious violent offender. When he comes out, he's even worse than he started. This individual may find that he has limited job options. He has limited housing options. He's not sure how to put his life back together again. But you know what? This guy behind bars told him, look, if you go to this particular corner at this particular time, you can start dealing. You can build a life for yourself again. So he starts to deal. You know, I talk to people sometimes who are extreme tough on crime guys. And they say, look, I don't have a bone in my body that isn't dedicated on the crime issue to total public safety. I say to them, okay, in a state like Virginia, where Representative Scott is from, where the mayor is from, 95% of the people who go behind bars come out. And then they live next door to you and me. That's a public safety issue. And if you're concerned about making sure that those people are productive citizens, aren't going to hurt us again, then you need to be in a room like this. Mr. Tough on Crime has to be in a room like this, participating in a conversation like this. And I think that that message has really begun to resonate with a lot of people on the right. That's the public safety issue. The second issue is the cost question. And I'm glad we've talked a lot about that today. I've been picked on for talking about costs in the past. Once I gave a talk at Howard University, and the young, very passionate students said, you're talking too much about money. It's not just about money. No, it's not just about money. But we've got to live in a real world here. Especially elected officials have to take a look at things like costs every day. It's important to them, it's important to all of us. And the criminal justice system is out of control. I come from the state of Texas, as was mentioned earlier. My home state costs $50 a day to put somebody behind bars. It costs $2.99 to put them on probation. That is a vast difference. I didn't say the difference between $50 and $45. The difference between $50 and basically $3. Now, some people belong behind bars. We all understand that. And if we all have to cut the $50 check, then that's what we have to do. But when you've got, again, low-level, nonviolent offenders, first-time offenders, the notion that you would spend $50 rather than $2.99 to monitor that person is just fiscally irresponsible. There's no other word for it. So I think we really do have to start thinking about the cost issue. And as you can imagine, that message has resonated with a lot of conservatives. But the final message that has resonated with conservatives is the human dignity question. And I think we have reached a point where a number of people look around the society and something is beginning to feel very Orwellian. There are all of these human beings, these fellow Americans, locked up behind bars like animals in cages. Something about this is profoundly disturbing. Libertarians will talk about this all the time. They use the George Orwell analogy all the time. Another group of people on the right who care a lot about this issue are social conservatives. I hear social conservatives, groups like prison fellowships, people associated with religious institutions say, we always say that we're the movement, we're the party that cares about family and family values. If you've got neighborhoods in this country where a third of all the fathers are locked up behind bars, that's family values? If we're gonna take that seriously, be the party and be the movement of family values, you've got to care about that issue. You've got to care about their children. With this has already been discussed today, and you don't need stats to know, just as a matter of common sense, that children of people who are incarcerated, less likely to graduate high school, more likely to abuse drugs, more likely to become pregnant as teenagers, obviously, more likely to go to prison themselves. That question of human dignity and what we're doing to individuals and to families and to neighborhoods is so profoundly important. And it's being discussed more and more on the political right. And it's a really, really exciting development. I would say it is the most exciting development on this issue in the last 10 years. Because when only 50% of the country is talking about the problem, we're not going to move forward. And now we've got a situation, this may be the only issue in the entire nation right now, where both sides are actually coming to the same place. Now, they're coming from different places. Sometimes the vocabulary and the language and the issues on both sides that are discussed are a little bit different. Everybody's getting to the same place. And we've already discussed a lot of the really wonderful advancements that have been made at the state level. I'm optimistic that there will be some terrific advancements at the federal level also. And these things are sort of an interesting cycle, right? The states do something terrific, and then the feds learn from that, so they do something terrific. And the states learn from something interesting down there, and they do more, and it just keeps on moving, it keeps on turning, and things get better. And I feel very privileged to be, of all the public policy issues I could be working on, to be working on this one right now, because this is one that we can feel optimistic about. So I'm looking forward to our conversation, and thanks again so much for having me here.
Of this job is that I get to go work with everybody. I get to go talk to conservatives, I get to go talk to liberals, I get to go talk to libertarians, and we all have found some common ground on this very, very important issue of criminal justice reform. And Vikrant highlighted why conservatives have come to the table, and it's so important to have them at that table. You know, we have to do this together. And I think to emphasize the importance of how important it is to have everyone working together, I want to go back a little bit and do a little history lesson. And it's an important history lesson because this year is the anniversary of this history lesson. In 1986, 30 years ago this year, Congress created the mandatory minimum federal drug sentencing laws. These laws were created in a bipartisan manner. In fact, they passed unanimously. Unanimously. Democrats supported them. The Congressional Black Caucus supported them, unfortunately. Republicans supported them. And 30 years later, these laws are still on the books today. What has happened in the last 30 years? We've seen thousands of nonviolent, low-level people with minor criminal records go to federal prisons for 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, even life without parole. I'll share a story with you. This is one of the things that FAM has been doing to talk about this issue, is putting human faces on it, because nothing brings an issue home like a human face. It creates human empathy for the problem. Charcile Kellum, she, like many, many women who unfortunately get sentenced under these laws, had a long history of drug addiction that began when she was very, very young. She had a fractured home, turned to drugs very early, dropped out of high school. Eventually, as she got a little bit older, she was able to get clean for a while and stay clean. But then she got dragged back into drugs, began using again, became addicted again. And like many women who become addicts, she dated men who had drugs, who were drug dealers, who could give her free supplies of drugs. Of course, as you know, many of you know, when people are involved with drugs over a long period of time, they tend to rack up a little bit of a criminal record. Charcile had one. The most serious thing on her criminal record was resisting arrest, receiving stolen property, obtaining public assistance by false statement, possession of drugs, shoplifting. This was her criminal record. But then one day she got busted by the feds. And this time it was serious business. And because she had these prior convictions, she was considered a three strikes offender. She had two prior strikes for drug offenses. And third strike means you're out in the federal system. She got a life without parole sentence. Fortunately for Charcile, she is now out of prison because President Obama commuted her sentence earlier this year. But Charcile is one of the lucky ones. And as much as President Obama's commitment to criminal justice reform is inspiring, as wonderful as his commutation grants are to people who are serving far, far too long, it is not enough. And as you all know, January 20th next year, we get someone new. And we don't know if that policy and that practice of commutations is going to continue, which means that it's time for Congress to act. And unfortunately, it doesn't look like they're going to act this year. I'll give you the good news and the bad news. The good news is that there has never been this level of bipartisan support for sentencing reform in Congress. FAM's been around 25 years. I've been there 10 of them. I've never seen so many people in both parties interested in this topic. It's very exciting when I get calls from Republicans high in leadership positions, and they say, come talk to me about sentencing reform. This is really important. I think Speaker Ryan wants to do something on this issue this year. I need to know about this. It's also really exciting to see Democrats banding together, because what I've learned doing this is that you can't always count on Democrat votes for criminal justice reform. There is still a lot of fear of looking soft on crime if they give a break to drug offenders. There are some of these Democrats who are in purple states, or even red states, who are worried about losing votes, losing voters, losing elections in their home states. And 2018, looking forward a little bit, is going to be a very important election year because a lot of Democrats are going to be up for election in the Senate. And a lot of them come from those reddish, purplish states. And we need to get to those Democrats and convince them that this is not soft on crime. In fact, this is the toughest thing they can possibly do on crime. Why is drug sentencing reform the toughest thing that Democrats can do on crime? Because it's expensive. Because we are spending money to keep Charcia Kellum in federal prison for life, when instead we could be investing that money in lots and lots of different ways. If Congressman Scott had his druthers, of course, all of those savings would go to education and crime prevention and doing better services for young people. But there are lots of other ways that we could spend that money too. Victim services, getting better resources to police, better police training, better rehabilitation programs in prison. A lot of people come out of federal prison right now and they recidivate. The rate is 50%. If you had a smartphone that only worked half the time, you would give that smartphone back and you'd ask for a refund, wouldn't you? Well, us taxpayers don't have that luxury in the criminal justice system, yet the federal criminal justice system is failing half the time. We need to do better about rehabilitation in prisons. It is tough on crime to stop putting people like Charcia Kellum in prison for too long and start putting that money where it's going to make a difference, where it's going to make us safer. And that's a message that we need to get to Democrats in the years ahead. We still have work to do. This Congress, I would say we had sort of three sentencing bills go forward. We had the big, the medium, and the small. The big one is Congressman Scott's Safe Justice Act. This would have made sure that people like Tresil didn't get a mandatory minimum sentence. It would have applied mandatory sentences to the people Congress intended them for back in 1986, which were the kingpins, the big dogs, the people at the very tip top making the big bucks. Unfortunately, that bill has not advanced. The other bill was the Smarter Sentencing Act, also a Bobby Scott bill. That would have just said, let's just deal with sentence length and make the sentence lengths more reasonable. Let's just cut them in half. All these drug mandatory sentences, 20 years goes down to 10, 10 goes down to 5, 5 goes down to 2. Let's just spend less money, do less prison time. Unfortunately, that bill even was seen as going too far. And what we have now is, in the House, it's called the Sentencing Reform Act. In the Senate, it's called the Sentencing Reform and Corrections Act. And they're quite complicated. And they don't go nearly as far as the medium or the big bills. They have a lot of tweaks in them, a lot of small adjustments, some important reforms. Charcia Kellum would have gotten a 10-year mandatory minimum under that bill, which I still think is probably too much time for her. But even as we've been here today, the New York Times put out an article with Senator Durbin saying, unfortunately, this bill, the small bill, is now not going to get a vote. So that's where we're at now. Thus is the way it goes with sentencing reform in election years. Election years tend to be terrible times to try to pass sentencing reform. In FAM's experience, that's usually when Congress passes new mandatory sentences or makes them worse. So we still have work to do. It's still bipartisan work to do. We need more Republicans. We need more Democrats. We need to also bring these folks out of the 1980s. We have had a whole generation now that has passed. We are so much smarter than we were in 1986 when we created these laws. October 27th of this year will be the 30th anniversary of President Reagan's signing of these laws. I think it should be the last anniversary of those laws. I think that we should be moving boldly to getting rid of them, addressing the issues like those in Charcia's case that are about addiction and mental illness, and trying to actually apply some science and all of the knowledge that we gained over the last 30 years to dealing with crime. Because we all deserve better than a 50% recidivism rate. We all deserve better than sending someone like Charcia Kellum to prison to die. That is not smart criminal justice policy. It's not tough on crime criminal justice policy. And I'm counting on all of you to go take that message to Democrats, to Republicans, to whoever represents you in Congress when you leave here today. Thank you.
Thank you, Molly. Just before we open questions to the audience, I'd like to give our panelists an opportunity, including Congressman Scott. They have a very brief parting point that they didn't get to mention in the presentation that they'd like to go out at this time.
I'd like to get to the questions. I just point out that everything that Molly just mentioned as alternative uses of savings, all of them were allowable uses under the Safe Justice Act.
What else? Okay, so we have a mic, or do we need that for the room? Or? So if you would raise your hand, and I'll just call the chair.
Yes, my name is Ceola Davis Burns from the South Suburbs of Chicago, Illinois. Robin Kelly is my representative. I've been hearing conversation regarding drugs and the sentencing reform. What about nonviolent white collar crime criminals housed at that UN. And I wanted to know if them was doing anything to promote or make any efforts for promoting victims who are white collar criminals.
Thank you for the question. It's one that we increasingly get at families. What's going on with white collar crime? I think the unfortunate news, there's a good side and a bad side to this. The good side is that there, so far, are not very many mandatory minimum sentences in the federal code for white collar crimes, and we want to keep it that way. We think mandatory sentences are bad in every case. They're always going to produce some kind of absurd result at some point in time, so let's just avoid it. So that's the good news. The bad news is that instead of really looking at white collar crime and having sort of a thoughtful conversation about some of the issues that those crimes raise, more often than not what we see are people just say, let's put a new mandatory sentence on a white collar crime. So right now we're playing a lot of defense against adding mandatory sentences to white collar crimes. But it is a really important issue. It's a big area in the federal prison population, and that population is growing. Excuse me. I think one of the meaningful conversations that has to happen around white collar crime is, do these people really need to be in federal prison? Are federal prisons for scary, dangerous, violent people, or are they for people who committed fraud, stole lots of people's money, did some terrible things perhaps, but are we going to preserve the use of prisons for the truly violent, the truly dangerous? And basically, we're not having that conversation right now.
And something about this, we talk about mandatory sentences, we fight against them, and as well we should, but the majority of people don't go to prison because of mandatory. There's an enormous amount of judicial discretion that gets exercised and prosecutorial discretion that gets exercised that puts people in prison that has nothing to do with a mandatory. 90% of people who come to the federal court go to prison and have some incarceration as part of their sentence. That's a stunning number. But nowhere in the states is that replicated. And most of that are nonviolent offenders, and most of that are discretionary. They're not mandatory. Molly, am I right about that? Not that I'm saying we should get rid of mandatories, and I think that mandatories make that possible, just like the death penalty makes life without the possibility of parole seem like a slap on the wrist. A 20-year mandatory sentence makes judges feel really good about giving some first offender 5 years. They feel like they gave the guy a break. But they have the discretion to put people in the community and have guidelines. Those guidelines aren't mandatory anymore. So if Congress won't act, there are plenty of other places we can take our complaints.
Well, I would say you're definitely right about the fact that the federal prison system pretty much uses prison for everything. If you're busted in a federal and taken to federal court, you're going to go to prison, straight to prison, go and collect $200. Probation is extremely rare in the federal system. And that's something we need to look at. It wasn't always that way. The probation rate has declined significantly over the last 30 years, and it doesn't have to be like that. And again, I just think we're not having that conversation in this country about who our prison cell is for. And it's an important conversation that we need to start having.
Molly, do you have a number of the people in jail that are in jail today on mandatory minimums? Because I suspect that, just look at the number of people going, if 10 people go for 1 year and one person goes on a 10-year mandatory minimum, half the people in jail will be there under mandatory minimums.
Yeah, there's about 195,000 people in federal prison right now. I believe the last number I saw, which is at least a year old, was about 80,000 of them are there with mandatory minimum sentences. I didn't really mention it, but the other area where mandatory federal sentences are used a lot is with gun crimes. So the minute that a gun shows up in a case, even if it's a legally owned gun, even if the person wasn't using the gun, there may be an extra mandatory minimum sentence attached to that. The sentence could get longer even if you don't get a mandatory minimum sentence for that gun. So guns are another area where we have a lot of work to do on mandatory sentencing laws.
So I just want to add one more thing to that, I'm sorry. So when I showed up in New York, there was a big fight about mostly abolished. And in New York City, I looked at the data, I was way on top of it, I was commissioner of probation for New York City. If you look at the curve, there's a sharp decline in the number of people getting locked up for drug offenses in New York from New York City, and was completely unaffected by the abolition of the Rockefeller drug laws. The curve went straight through as if the Rockefeller drug laws never happened. And the reason for that is because New York City policymakers, before Albany could act, were so offended by the Rockefeller drug laws, they basically were bargaining around them, led by Joe Hines in Brooklyn, but other prosecutors came along. They were basically saying to guys, I'm going to not prosecute, most of the guys, gals too, I'm not prosecuting your case. I'm going to send you to drug treatment. If you do okay on drug treatment, this case is going away, and I'm going to drop it down to a misdemeanor, or maybe it'll be a felony, but it won't be a felony affected by drug laws. So I don't want to take anything away from the righteous fight against mandatory minimums, but don't let people go. Officials get off the hook. They can do plenty of stuff. They just did this, the prosecutors in New York, just like Paul is famous for exercising his discretion as a prosecutor. Prosecutors have an enormous amount of discretion to affect who doesn't go to prison. So we shouldn't just pull our hair out about, oh, let's go out. They're all caught up in their fights. They are. But plenty of other people, and President Obama took leadership on this and told his prosecutors, stop sending these low-level nonviolent offenders to prison. And guess what they did? They kind of did that. They didn't do enough of it. I'm sure we could all say there should be more. But they exercised their discretion in a way that prevents people from going to prison.
So good afternoon. I'm Chester James, Vice President of Father Support Center in the city of St. Louis. And my question to this esteemed panel, and I want to thank the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation for having this. When will the justice system start labeling the police killings against black men and women as a criminal offense and not brutality, and sentence them to prison?
One of the problems we have with the using the criminal justice system to control policing is you have to prove the case guilty beyond a reasonable doubt. Particularly in the killings, you have a problem with that because you're only hearing one side of the story unless you have a body camera. And so the fact that you need guilt beyond a reasonable doubt is problematic. And one thing that could be very helpful is if you have independent prosecution, when you have an inherent conflict of interest from the local prosecutor working daily with the police is the one to investigate his friends and colleagues. If you have an independent investigation, you're more likely to get a better independent result. But the civil accountability, where you can sue for damages, Senator Blaine's family yesterday, the day before, received a significant settlement. Freddie Gray's family received a significant settlement. The winning cases, either in the court or by settlement in civil, where your standard is not guilty on reasonable doubt, but preponderance of the evidence, more likely than not, then you get into damages. Everybody talks about lowering the standard, but if you're trying to put somebody in jail, I'm not sure that we want to change the idea that you can kill beyond the reasonable doubt. That will make the criminal justice system always problematic. If you want to reduce the incidence of police killing, one, we have to use our democratic, make democracy work. Ferguson figured that out. Ferguson, Missouri figured that out after Michael Brown was killed.
Yes, sir.
They looked up 65% black city, handful of black police officers. How'd that happen? Well, they slept through the municipal election. The election after that, they woke up and voted. Mayor's gone, police chief's gone, one of the local prosecutors gone, had the ballot box. Now, the new people have to be held accountable, make sure they do right, make sure you're hiring the right police officers, and make sure they're policing in a way that you want policing done. That's a political decision. And you can't sleep through an election and think, that we're going to be able to have that impact. But the accountability is one thing after the fact. I think we'd be much better off and make much more ground. You have to do the accountability with prevention, and that means police training to make sure they know what de-escalation means, center of when. People watch the tape and analyze that each step of the way the police officer allowed the situation to escalate, should have stepped back, take a deep breath, everybody calm down. You don't have to get into those kinds of situations. De-escalation, figure out what implicit bias means. There is, under the radar bias that most people don't know they have, there are ways of training to compensate for that. How to police without profiling. There are a lot of things you can do to significantly reduce the chance that any of these incidents will take place. We have to do them all. Waiting for the incident to occur and then use the criminal justice system. And if you look around the country, how often they're able to get an indictment and a conviction. The only one I've seen, you get about 1,000 police shootings a year. The only prosecution I've heard of recently is one in Portsmouth, Virginia, in that district, where a young prosecutor brought the police officer to court and, in fact, got a conviction. Critic Ray's cases were all indicted. And if you listen to the editorial in the paper, they praise the prosecutor for bringing the case, but the standard is probable cause that a crime has been committed. You can bring an indictment. But to get the conviction, you need beyond a reasonable doubt. So they praised her for bringing the case. And then after the judge had dismissed a couple of them, it was obvious they weren't going to be able to prove guilt beyond a reasonable doubt. Dropping the case, he also praised that decision. But we have to make the system work. You have to have a prosecutor that's willing to stand up and do the right thing. Try to get independent prosecution. But go to prevention and early intervention as a primary source of reducing.
I'm sorry, I know there are other comments, and I know there are other questions, but we have to get